Cocoon is a protective casing of silk filament which the silkworm spins around to protect itself and to pass through the delicate process of metamorphosis undisturbed by external features. The qualitative and quantitative parameters of cocoons are greatly determined by mulberry leaf, environment, rearing technique, silkworm race, silkworm seed, etc. Besides mountages, mounting technology, harvesting and transportation of cocoons. It is well established fact that silkworm rearing, including mounting and harvesting of cocoons, are the labor intensive and timeliness operations apart from influencing the cocoon quality and quantity. Even if the silkworm crop is healthy and cocoons are well built, untimely and improper method of harvesting cocoons can be fatal to the cocoon crop to maximize profit by the farmers. For the purpose of better understanding, the topic of cocoon harvesting process has been divided into different subheadings: cocoon harvesting, cocoon assortment, cocoon assessment, cocoon storage and transportation, preparation of cocoon harvest report. The two most important aspects involved in cocoon harvesting are time and method of harvesting. Time of harvesting: the larvae, after spinning the cocoon, molts and transforms into pupa. The newly formed pupa is pale in color and has a very soft cuticle which ruptures easily if disturbed. The cuticle hardens into a tough brown structure in a day and within the pupae. The larval organs are histolyzed and adult organs are differentiated. When fully formed adult emerges from the pupa, breaks open the cocoon and come out. Harvesting must be done after the pupal cuticle has hardened and before the adult emerges. In tropical multivoltine and bivoltine races, pupal cuticle hardened on the third or fourth day of spinning, and in temperate univoltines and bivoltines on the fourth or fifth day of spinning. The recommended time of harvesting is fifth day of spinning for tropical races and seventh or eighth day in temperate races. Delay in harvesting beyond the recommended day may lead to the formation of pierced cocoon by moth emergence. Too early harvesting leads to soiled cocoons inside due to the putrefaction of pupa injured by harvesting. Therefore, it is safe to conduct cocoon harvesting after hardening of the pupal cuticle, and it can be tested by shaking the cocoon gently. Method of harvesting: cocoon harvesting method depends on the type of mountage used for spinning cocoons. Before harvesting the cocoons from the cocooning frame, it is advisable to remove all the unspun larvae, dead larvae, thin end, flimsy and stained cocoons, etc. Those can soil other good cocoons. In most of the mountages like Chandrike, plastic collapsible mountage, etc., harvesting has to be done manually and it takes lot of labor. In the case of a bottle brush mountage, harvesting can be done by hand using a short iron rake. For collapsible mountage, the frame is stretched to both sides to deform the wave shape and cocoon can be collected from both sides. In case of rotary cocooning frame, first each of the 10 cardboard mountages are removed from the wooden frame after keeping it vertically. Then the dead worms, flimsy cocoons, etc. are removed from the mountages. The cocoon frame is inserted on a wooden frame and cocoons are pushed out one line after another by a cocoon pusher. Cardboard frames are then folded and bundled. Pushed out cocoons from the cardboard mountage is employed. It can be 10 times faster than the hand pusher and more efficient in a mass rearing. After cocoons are harvested, the cocooning frame can be exposed to sunlight for 1 or 2 days for disinfection and can be stored properly for next rearing. Floss removal. The cocoon has three layers, namely floss, shell and pellade. Both floss and pellade layers are non-reelable, while shell is reelable. However, floss or blaze layer, though formed of continuous filament, is a tangled mass and is unreelable. In univoltines and bivoltines, floss layer forms only 2% by weight of the entire cocoon, but in multivoltines, it forms nearly 10%. In this context, it is necessary that floss covering the cocoon must be removed before marketing for getting a good price for cocoons. Floss can be removed by hand if the cocoon quantity is small. If quantity is more, a floss removing machine, that is deflosser, can be employed. While using a machine, only a small quantity of cocoons should be fed each time to avoid crushing of cocoon, in addition to removing thin shelled cocoons. After harvesting and floss removal from cocoons, the cocoons are sorted out to separate the defective cocoons from the cocoon lot by silkworm rearer before marketing the cocoons, as the presence of defective cocoons in a lot reduces the price. It is pertinent to note that occurrence of defective cocoons cannot be totally avoided. However, much care is taken in silkworm rearing. In properly reared batches, there will generally be not more than 10 to 15% of defective cocoons due to genetic character, silkworm diseases, improper mountage and mounting, etc. As the defective cocoons are not suitable for economic reeling of raw silk, and hence a reeler prefers to purchase cocoons which are healthy and reelable and unmixed with defective cocoons. The causes for unreelable cocoons during cocooning and measures to reduce their occurrence are as follows. Double cocoons. These cocoons are the cocoons jointly formed by two or more worms. The double cocoons are also called jointed cocoons or combined cocoons or associated cocoons. They are large in size and thick in shell. Such cocoons cannot be reeled for raw silk productivity. However, double cocoons are used to produce dupion silk. The occurrence of double cocoons depends on kind of mountage, density of spinning larvae, silkworm race, and also mounting care. As it is not a genetic character, these types of cocoons can be used for seed production. Immature cocoons. Immature cocoons are those where the pupal formation is incomplete. This occurs usually when cocoons are harvested prematurely. Therefore, to avoid occurrence of immature cocoons, harvesting should be performed when pupa appears dark brown in color, slightly shrunken in size with glistering eyes. Malformed cocoons. Overcrowding at the time of spinning and use of inferior quality mountages lead to malformed cocoons. These cocoons are abnormal in shape, scaffold, pressed, or cocoons having non-uniform texture of cocoon shell, rendering them unfit for seed cocoon as well as for commercial reeling. Thin end cocoons. One end or both ends of a cocoon are very thin and not amenable for reeling. It is often due to genetic character, high temperature during incubation, malnutrition during rearing, or strong wind under humid condition in the mounting room. These cocoons are invariably formed in multivoltine races. Thin shell cocoons. Thin shell occurs when the crop is generally bad due to malnutrition or diseases. Loose knit or fragile cocoons. Loosely built with open space between layers constituting the shell from knit or fragile cocoons. These cocoons are formed due to silkworm race itself, as in multivoltine races, and also due to high temperature during cocooning. Cocoon frame printed cocoons. While cocooning, a part of cocoon surface adheres to the cocooning frame imprinted by the later. Even if it is small, Raw silk cannot be reeled from such cocoons. This problem occurs when the material used for montage making is too hard or cocooning space is too small. Soiled cocoons. Cocoons which are soiled by urination or diseased larvae cannot be reeled economically. This occurs due to the kind of montage and high density of mounting. Sometimes the worms die after spinning silk or just after pupation and soil the inner layer of the cocoon shell. This is due to carelessness in mounting and handling of cocoons. Melted cocoons. This occurs mainly due to high temperature. The pupae inside the cocoon get killed. Open end pierced cocoons. Cause for this defect is mainly due to the silkworm race itself or due to piercing of cocoons by maggot of Ouija fly. Calcified cocoons. In these types of cocoons, pupae are destroyed due to attack of fungus called Botrytis bassiana. Undersized cocoons. These cocoons are below normal in size with a thin cocoon shell and very low cocoon shell ratio. These cocoons should not be used for silkworm seed production. Mute cocoons. Pupa become dead and sticks to the shell inside the cocoon and hence doesn't make any sound when shaken. Decaying pupa sometimes releases putrefying body fluid which stains the cocoon shell. Percentage of defective cocoons can be limited to 15% or less if mounting is done properly. But if care is not taken during mounting, the percentage of such cocoons can be as high as 30%. To reduce the appearance of non-reliable cocoons, following measures should be undertaken. Selection of an ideal mountage. Mounting operation should be simple and avoid overcrowding of larvae. Matured worms should be mounted as early as possible. Providing optimum environmental conditions during spinning of cocoons by the larvae and keep the mountage away from direct sunlight and strong wind. Harvesting of cocoons should be done only after completion of pupation and care should be taken during transportation of cocoons. The cocoons are assessed for their quality as these are varied greatly among silkworm races, rearing environment, techniques of silkworm rearing adopted, etc. Physical characteristics of cocoons. Cocoon color. Color is the racial character and is due to the presence of coloring pigments in the sericin layer of the bave. Generally, bivoltine cocoons are white and multivoltine cocoons are colored cocoons. They are golden yellow, greenish yellow, light green, pink, etc. These colors except green are due to the coloring of sericin and will disappear after degumming of raw silk. These colors are changeable in the tint under the influence of temperature and humidity during rearing. Cocoon shape. The shape of cocoon is a racial character but to some extent influenced by the mountages. Cocoons can be classified into elliptical, spherical and spindle and can be further subdivided into long, short, highly constricted, deeply constricted, etc. Japanese races are usually constricted, Chinese races are elliptical or spherical and tropical races are spindle in shape. Cocoon size. The dimensions and consequently the volume of the cocoon varies from race to race. It is greatly influenced by rearing, environmental conditions and the amount of feed available. Volume of cocoon is measured by number of cocoons per liter. Compactness or hardness of cocoon. This represents the level of stiffness and elasticity. When the cocoon shell is pressed with finger, if it is felt stiff and elastic, it is called compact. And when it is loose and non-elastic, it is called less compact. Extent of firmness and tightness of cocoon shell indicates cell structure and hardness and these will influence on permeability of air and water at the time of cooking. Though it is a racial character, it is greatly influenced by rearing and mounting conditions. grains or wrinkles on cocoon. The wrinkling and irregularities on the surface of the cocoon are termed as grains. The closeness or sparseness of the convolutions indicates the degree of granulation. These granules are coarser in outer layer than in inner layers. Appearance of wrinkles is a racial character but can be affected by environmental conditions. Cocoons with extreme wrinkles are not suitable for reeling. Commercial characteristics of cocoons. Cocoon weight. It is very important from the viewpoint of reeling. Cocoon weight shows a continuous loss of weight from the time of its completion till the emergence of the moth because of loss of moisture. Pupae lose moisture about 15% till about a day or prior to emergence due to natural evaporation of moisture from the body of the pupae and also due to metamorphosis. Cocoon weight varies with silkworm race, rearing condition and mulberry leaf. Female cocoons are heavier than male cocoons. Shell weight. The shell weight is more important than the cocoon weight as it is the shell that yields the silk for reeling. Thus, higher the weight of the cocoon shell, more is the raw silk content. Weight of cocoon shell is dependent on race, rearing condition and quantity and quality of mulberry leaves fed. Shell ratio. It is the ratio between the weight of the cocoon shell and the cocoon weight expressed in percentage. Shell ratio is obtained by dividing the weight of cocoon shell by the weight of cocoon multiplied by 100. Shell ratio fairly indicates the quantity of raw silk that can be reeled from the cocoons and also helps in estimating randita and thereby fixing a proper price for the cocoons. Shell ratio is higher in male cocoons than in female cocoons and is dependent on race, environmental conditions, quality and quantity of mulberry leaves fed to the worms, type of mountages used and mounting method adopted. Filament length. It is the total length of the reelable silk bev in the cocoon. Length of cocoon filament has an intimate relation with the efficiency of reeling operation. Length of cocoon filament differs according to the silkworm race, rearing and mounting conditions and quality and quantity of mulberry leaves fed. Filament weight. It is the weight of cocoon filament reeled from a single cocoon. It is directly proportional to the weight of cocoon shell but changes according to the reelability of cocoon. The weight of cocoon filament is approximately 80 to 90% of the weight of the cocoon shell. Filament thickness. The thickness of cocoon filament is expressed in terms of denier. Denier is the weight in grams of 9000 meters of yarn or filament. Denier is obtained by dividing the weight of filament by the length of the filament multiplied by 9000. Thickness of the filament is dependent on silkworm race, rearing and mounting conditions. Cocoon quality will be affected by pressing of cocoon against each other while handling. Damage by parasitic insects, spoilage caused by excessive evaporation and heat during fresh cocoon storage. Hence, cocoons must be stored at optimum temperature of 25 degree centigrade to 27 degree centigrade and relative humidity of 60 to 65% in a thin layer to prevent loss of moisture from cocoons. The evaporation of moisture from the cocoon is about 1 gram per 100 cocoons per day. Moisture evaporation from female cocoon is more than male cocoon. The dryage loss of green cocoon when stored in trays as thin layer ranged from 2.47 to 4.70% per day and the cumulative loss in 7 days will be between 15.71 to 20.03%. If the cocoons are stored in the form of EIF, then the temperature rises by 50 degree centigrade within 15 hours of storage, which will affect the quality of cocoons and reliability. Cocoon transportation. The method of transport, distance and time of transport of cocoons have impact on the quality and moisture loss. Green cocoons needs to be packed loosely in bamboo container and cover the mouth with thin cloth to provide good aeration and prevent evaporation. Avoid using thick cloth bag, polythene bag, etc., which doesn't permit adequate ventilation. Cocoons are transported as headload by man on bicycle, bullock cart, car, tempo or lorry, and on top of bus, depending upon the distance and quantity. Proper care should be taken while loading into tempo or lorry, preferably in system, not by heaving or dumping. Rough handling of cocoons affects pupa and in turn the cocoon shell and reliability. Preferably, transportation is undertaken during cool hours of the day. This is mainly to reduce the drayage loss during transit. Further, loss in drayage is positively correlated with distance and mode of transportation. Hence, cocoons should not be transported for longer distance to avoid the ill effects on cocoon quality. The purpose of silkworm rearing is to harvest higher yields of cocoons with superior quality. However, much of the value of experience is lost without suitable records or reports. Reports preserve experience and properly analyzed data bring out its real significance. The reports, besides making the rarer prawn oriented, also provide valuable facts to be used in future planning. To be real help in running a silkworm rearing operation, the reports need to be kept in a systematic and duly classified form so that they can be summarized and to give a concise and precise picture of the rearing operations over the years. Such reports can serve another useful purpose of making comparison with the successful rearing under the similar rearing conditions. The following details are to be included in the preparation of harvest report on cocoon production. Number 1. Silkworm race or breed or hybrid or crossbreed. Number 2. Number of disease free layings brushed. Number 3. Source of silkworm seed. Number 4. Mulberry variety. Number 5. Percentage of egg hatch. Number 6. Date of hatching of silkworm eggs. Number 7. Method of brushing silkworm. Number 8. Method of engage silkworm rearing. Number 9. Method of latest silkworm rearing. Number 10. Method and number of bed cleanings. Number 11. Spacing of silkworms. Number 12. Season of silkworm rearing. Number 13. Date of mounting silkworms. Number 14. Method of mounting silkworms. Number 15. Types of mountages. Number 16. Incidence of pests and management strategies adopted during rearing. Number 17. Incidence of diseases and management strategies adopted during rearing. Number 17. Details of feeding and molting durations. Number 19. Date of cocoon harvest. Number 20. Yield of cocoons per 100 DFLs. Number 21. Percentage of good and defective cocoons. Details of number of labors employed. Number 22. Date of marketing of cocoons. Number 23. Price and total value of cocoons. The topic cocoon harvesting process can be concluded that time and method of harvesting cocoons is of prime importance to obtain superior quality of cocoons, and these can be further subjected to assortment or sorting for separation of defective cocoons from the good ones. Later, they are deflossed, assessed, stored if necessary, and transported to cocoon markets to obtain better price.